topic is different that I have to talk about. Okay, so all these questions are the priority in a patient's mind, because the doctor does not speak in a language which they understand. I know somebody was talking, one of the doctors now also, and they use some technical terms. And from a patient's point of view, it's non-understandable. The patient wants the doctor to understand what is being said. The patient wants the doctor to allow him the time to ask questions. And the one main thing that the patient wants is that the doctor should make him feel comfortable. I think it's very, very important that the patient is comfortable, which means that the golden thumb rule has to be that there is a establishment of a perfect rapport between a patient and a doctor. But it can't be a reality with this unproportionate patient-doctor ratio. It is everywhere. I know we are ourselves to blame for it because of our need to go out into cities, bigger towns, go away to the other countries. And so the ratio of doctors and patients falls to one doctor for 1,588 patients. Very, very disproportionate. I know in cities, like somebody mentioned, that you have one patient and you have five doctors attending to him, but that's really not the reality. There's a patient on one side and there's a physician on the other side, and there's this huge gap. And now we all have to work together to address this challenge. First of all, the patient expects that the doctor is empathetic towards the patient. That means that we are not looking, as a patient, I'm not looking for somebody to sympathize. As a patient, I'm looking for somebody to understand my problem and empathize with my problem and take the case from there. What I as a patient would need, that whatever I'm saying is in confidence, the doctor understands what I'm saying, he's competent. If he does not understand my problem, I would appreciate if the doctor says, I'm sorry, but I cannot deal with it. There's somebody else who can help you out. And that will lead me to respect my doctor and treat him as a friend more than anything else. And then I would like a doctor to understand the values that I share. It could be spiritual values, it could be family values, it could be any other thing. Now, what I want from a doctor is that I should be seen and get the results in a timely manner. Or I should be at least told that, it would take so many days for your results to come, so that I'm prepared for the wait. And then, otherwise, the doctor says, but the patients are not patient enough. But I am patient if I have been told how much time it would take. Then, whenever there is a result, when I got my cancer diagnosed, I remember the doctor came in my room when I was all by myself and said, I need to talk to you about something and tell you something. I can never forget that moment, because that was a confidence that I built with the doctor, that he was sharing the bad result with me and also giving me the pep talk at that time. So that is what I think makes a lot of difference. And then with the medicines, what will be the side effects? Again, coming back to my own treatment, I can tell you when I was told that it's going to be chemotherapy, and my first reaction was, would I lose my hair? And the doctor said, maybe, maybe not. But why? In my Hodgkin's, they knew very well that I'm going to lose my hair. So what prevented the doctor from telling me the truth, that it's going to be a hair loss, but we will know how to deal with that hair loss. You can get wigs made, you can do this or you can do that. That would have reassured me. So as a patient, I want the doctor to be honest with me. And of course, like I said, it has to be terms that I can understand and not big technical words. Again, I remember, when I was given the chemotherapy, I told the doctor, can I have some information? Because at that time, there was no information booklets on chemotherapy which I could read. And he gave me a very, very highly technical scientific book. And he said, you can read and you can understand, and so you take this book. And it had all the side effects of the drugs that were going to be given to me. And I was wondering, why am I going in for chemotherapy? Because I know I'm not going to be living, because either my heart will fail or my organs will fail or something or the other is going to happen. So does it make sense to give something like that to a patient? I don't think so. Every time we feel that the doctor says, it's okay, I'm taking care of you. But why? I'm not mentally unstable that I can't take care of my decisions. You need to explain it to me, and then I should be a party. It's my body that you are treating. Why should I not know what is going to happen to my body? So why can't I be a part of the decision-making process? And then during the time when the treatment is being done, one has to acknowledge the fact that I am stressed. I, the patient, is undergoing the stress. So why can't that respect be given for the stress that I am going to have? Why can't you understand? I may want a treatment after a certain time. I remember when I was diagnosed with cancer, and that's the time when my daughter was in doing her boards, class 10. So I asked the doctor, I said, is it the right time for going in for the surgery? Because, you know, her exams would get affected. Now, at that time, he said, you know, it really won't matter because if it has been delayed by so many months, a week delay will not matter. And that made a lot of difference to me because I did not have to share with my daughter anything till her results were, till her exams were over. And if it was somebody who said, no, you have to do it without telling me or listening to me, it would have mattered to me in a very big way. So these are the type of things which can really help a patient take the treatment in a very positive manner. Again, results and directions in simple terms. Just yesterday we got a patient who came to me and she said, these results have come to me but I don't understand what it means. And she's a doctor herself, but she's so shattered because she's got breast cancer that she doesn't have the ability to ask the doctor. And the doctor is probably presuming that she's a doctor and does not need to be explained. But as a patient, everybody is on the same platform. So if you can appreciate that fact and explain in simple terms, I think you will have a more understanding patient to treat. And of course, encouragement and compassion always goes. Again, you know, my doctor who had come to me when told me that I had cancer, he said, you know, I'm talking to you alone and I want you to fight. I don't want you to become a loser. And thanks to his encouragement, I must say, I was stage 3 Hodgkin's. That I was able to survive, I have been able to survive these 17 years and have been able to set up this support group. I think it was just that word that when he said that I don't want you to be a loser, I want you to be a fighter and I want you to fight. So I think these type of words go a long way. I mean, he must have spent that time, you know, he came at 10:30 at night to spend that time with me because I was going to be alone in the room and he was going to give me all these pearls of wisdom. So I think that is what really, really helps. Often we find that, you know, when we have concerns, like I used to write a list of all the questions knowing how busy the doctor would be and I would write my list and take. And, you know, whenever I went, the doctor started saying, so where's your shopping list? And that would hurt me. It's not a shopping list. It's my problems because I appreciate your time, that it is valuable, that I write out everything and bring. And then, you know, it hurt me so much. I mean, you're having humor and fun at my expense when I'm at that stage, when I'm most vulnerable. Is that desired? So next time I went there and he said, today you haven't come with your shopping list. I said, it doesn't matter to you anyway. So why should I bother? I can read up everything that I want to and that's fine. And then he probably realized and he said, no, I'm sorry, but you know, I just thought that you were very you come up with a very good system and all that. I said, yeah, so I wish you had said that the system is good, that I write out everything and come. But, you know, so have fun, have a light moment, share some nice things, but not at the expense of demoralizing a patient. And then alternative medicines and complementary medicines form a large part of everybody. We always hear, do this, it's going to help you. Do this, it's going to help you. When you go to the doctor will just brush it off and say, no, no, don't do that. But why? Why can't you say why I cannot do it? Is there a reason for it? Or is it because it hampers your practice? I mean, that's what I would begin to feel. But why not? Can you give me a reason for it? Again, I'll quote an example. You know, I was while I was having my chemotherapy, I used to go to my homeopath doctor who would talk to me and, like, you know, give me medicines and whatever. But I really didn't know what I was taking. But after my treatment got over and I started working in this support group, I realized that, you know, my side effects were far less than what people were undergoing. So I asked her, I said, you know, is there something that we can do for patients here? She said, you know, Vandana, I think it was just my talking to you which made a difference because I never did anything special. Now, that was honesty. And she said, if we want to do it as a research, what I can do is first start taking patients, putting the stages and all those things, and then working on it. That was a homeopath giving me this type of a logic.